We'll continue with our last series of advanced topics, and today we'll look at this notion of design principles. So what are the key design principles underlying a biological system? So if you look at some of the very first videos that we started off with modeling, we said that one of the loftiest goals of modeling is to be able to glean design principles from a given biological network. So how do you understand design principles? Right? So suppose you have to build an oscillator, or you have to build a system that shows adaptation. So what are all the different ways in which you can build it? And out of all the ways, are there some common, you can even call them a motive potentially, are there some common design principles that underlie these functionalities? So this is something that we will try to review today. There are some very interesting design principles that one observe in biology, and we already know a few of them, right? So we did talk about how robustness is important and what are the design principles underlying robustness. If you were to design a system, as we will talk about when we go into synthetic biology, you want it to be robust, you want it to be maybe having some modularity, redundancy, and you know, good parametric and topological sensitivity. So in this context, I would like to discuss a very interesting paper. This was published by Ma and co-workers in 2009 in Cell. And the paper was defining biochemical topologies, something of the sort, capable of achieving perfect adaptation, right? But you could also think about, you could just replace this with anything, right? So there are papers which I've studied about positive feedback switches or circadian oscillators and so on, fold chain systems, so on and so forth. There are many interesting such studies, right? But how do you actually identify a circuit that performs this function? This is, you know, this is also related to ensemble modeling and so on and so forth, but what would be a strategy to find such a circuit, right? So if you go back to what we discussed about robustness and so on, we started talking about a topology space and so on, right? So in that topology space, how do you find the one circuit that optimizes your design requirements, right? So this would be a classic synthetic biology problem wherein you have a design requirement. So let us say you want oscillations, right? So how would you characterize an oscillation? You would characterize it by its amplitude and frequency. So what is the amplitude, what is the frequency, right? So now, so in Ma's case, they were looking at something called perfect adaptation. So there is a step perturbation, and what is the response to this? So do you have something like this, do you have something like this, do you have something like this, and so on? And they quantified what they called perfect adaptation. They said the relative change in output to input must be a particular quantity, and so on and so forth. So there is a very specific design requirement. So essentially, let us just say all of these translate to some design requirements, right? So now you are confronted with the task of finding a topology or a set of topologies which can comply with this design requirement. So can this oscillate, right? And we did see this is the classic reciprocator and it can oscillate, but how do you find out if this is a good oscillatory circuit? Is this better? Is this worse? Right? So there are such interesting questions that one can ask about how do you design such circuits. And when we go into synthetic biology, this becomes the key question: how do you reliably design circuits? And there are many other interesting aspects to it. What happens when you integrate such a circuit into a cell? Is there some crosstalk? Do things go wrong, and so on? So these are things that one wants to worry about, and you may want to worry about these at the design stage itself. You can't basically build a system, then stick it in, and then see if it or it doesn't work, and then see how do you want to manipulate it and so on. So can you actually design it? Take these factors into consideration during design. So the idea is, what Ma did was they had a particular design requirement, and then what they did was a brute force search. This goes back to what we discussed a little earlier during robustness. So how many 3 node circuits are possible? Right, this is roughly exactly 19683. There are some which are disconnected and so on. So basically it comes down to around 16k, and what they did was they actually considered 10 to the 4 parameter sets sampled at random for each of these 16k circuits and performed therefore how many 1.6 into 10 to the 8 simulations. And then they came up with something really startling. They found that only the 2 types of nodes. So
395 combinations of them, they gave the ideal response.
Okay. Yeah. So this is roughly about 395 topologies which fell into 2 families essentially, more or less. Right. So negative feedback with loop with buffering node, and incoherent feed forward loop with proportioning node, right. So these were the 2 families of topologies. The important aspect is not that, but the important aspect is they actually had to carry out nearly 0.16 billion simulations to come up with this solution. Are there other ways to do it? For example, so there are people in my lab who are working on control theoretic approaches to actually figure this out. Can you say that this is the only way this system can, this sort of a behavior can emerge from a control theoretic perspective? And because there is a lot of knowledge on how control systems work and so on, and can you integrate ideas from control theory to essentially come up with these, right? But this is a classic question in synthetic biology, which we will start looking at. Right? So in all of these cases, they had to do some sort of sampling and evaluation of performance. There are papers which have previously done this for say circadian oscillators, right. In circadian oscillators, you again set up a circadian some set or sort of a system, and then you sample parameters and then evaluate. Evaluation is easy. You just find out if it oscillates or it just damps out or you get nothing, right. So you can get different behaviors, where this is an acceptable behavior, these are unacceptable behaviors. So what topologies? So you can maybe say that this topology gives this behavior 36% of the time, which is a good thing, right. And there might be other topologies which give you an oscillatory behavior like 10% of the time, which may not be a reliable way to synthesize such topologies synthetically. Parameter space, right. So you have a particular parameter space, so the volume of this is 36%, right, across dimensions, right. This could be a 9 dimensional parameter, say a space or something like that. So I hope I introduced you to the very interesting concept of design principles in today's video, right. So we always want to understand the key design aspects of any biological function, be it an oscillation or an adaptation and so on. And this is a very open field, and there are many people working to understand what are the key design principles underlying different types of biological function. So we in fact did look at some design principles of underlying robustness earlier, like potentially redundancy and so on. And today we discussed about a different set of design principles. In the next video, we will try to wind up this course on systems biology. We will look at an interesting paper that talks about how one goes about bridging the gaps in systems biology, the importance of model standards, model composition, model integration, and interdisciplinary research. I will also talk to you about this very interesting thing known as dream challenges. I will briefly show you some pictures on whole cell modeling and what are the interesting concepts that underlie whole cell modeling, and also talk about this interesting concept called retroactivity.